Hello, vintage computer fans. Today I would like to present another machine from my retro computer collection, which is very dear to me. It is a Microprofessor MPF-1B from the company Multitech. It was introduced in 1981, and nowadays this company is known under the name Acer. Yeah, so this machine is actually still being sold and being produced, although not by Acer, but another company which acquired the rights. And it's a very neat machine for learning the basics of Z80 or Z80, as British folks would say, right? Z80 machine language programming. And it's quite functional, actually. I also have the printer option here, which is a rare piece, right? And I'm going to demonstrate this as well. So maybe a little tour of the board. Here we have the Z80 processor. It's not a Z80A, so it's clocked at 2 MHz. Then here we have the EEPROM, which contains the firmware, which is a monitor program for entering, debugging, and executing Z80 machine code, right, which is up and running here right now on the display. Then we have 2 kilobytes of system RAM here, which is used by the monitor as well as the built-in BASIC. So this ROM also contains a version of Palo Alto Tiny BASIC, and then we have, in my case here, a RAM. It's an 8 kilobytes of RAM, and the user RAM starts at address 1800, and in my case it extends all the way up to 3FFF, so you see a memory map here. Here we have the EEPROM, the monitor program, right? Then here's the Palo Alto Tiny BASIC, system RAM, and then all this region here from 2000 on to, in my case, 3FFF is this chip here, which is a 6264 SRAM with 8 kilobytes of RAM. So, but you could also plug in an EEPROM here, so if you wanted to execute a fixed program, right? So, but in my case, I have a lot of RAM here, which is great. So I'm going to demonstrate the Tiny BASIC another day, but just to show you that it's there, you know, it's at, like the memory map shows us, right? It starts at address 0800. So you can just start it from there, and there you have Tiny BASIC. Okay, but I think Tiny BASIC is not really where the machine shines. In my opinion, it really shines as a Z80 machine code, bare metal, development system, and it's quite functional for what it offers. So let's enter a little machine code program, right? So we start at address 1800, and I've prepared a little program here which I'm going to enter now, and if I hit the data button, then I can actually start entering the opcodes, the machine Z80 opcodes, right? So I'm not going to explain in detail what these opcodes mean, but later in this video I'm using the printer to disassemble this, and then we can actually understand what it does, and I'm going to explain it a little bit then. So for now, let me just enter this program. It's not long, and I can simply hit the plus button, right, to enter the opcode at that address and advance to the next address, which is quite useful, and I can navigate with plus and minus through the memory. So I was at DD21, and now I have 00 19 CD 24 06 F1 18 EC. So, and that is that. Now we can actually start the program, address 1800, and hit the go button, and you see what it does. It's just a basic counter, right? So yeah, then we can simply interrupt it, right? And unlike an 8-bit home computer, right, where you could of course also have a assembler, basically text space, etc. If you make a mistake in your machine code program, right, and you crash a machine, then usually your memory content is gone, right? This is not the case in these machines, right? So if you hit reset, all the machine crashes and you have to reset it. So the memory is still there, right? So you can simply continue. So, and this is, I think, what makes it really well suited for, machine language programming, because you don't have to save your work to disk all the time, because otherwise you'd lose the memory content. So let's extend that program a little bit, right, by adding sound output. You already hear the speaker here. So how about we extend this little program with a little bit of sound? And for this, I'm going to go to address 1814 and override the last jump instruction here. So that's basically a jump to a relative jump to the beginning of the loop, right? So I'm going to replace this now with some. Oops, that was the wrong button. I'm going to replace this with a little piece of code that does some sound output. You see, there's an interesting side effect of the sound output, right? The lower the frequency, the more the display flickers, and this is simply because the speaker is driven by a subroutine in the firmware monitor, which basically pulses the speaker, right? Like a pulse wave modulation. And with lower frequencies, it simply takes longer to output the number of cycles. And this is what causes the display to flicker. So the program actually runs slower for lower frequency tones, right? So yeah, reset. And now maybe instead of having a decreasing sound, let's have an increasing sound. And so there's simply a counter here, right? And if you know a little bit of Z80 machine code, then you know that 3C increments the accumulator. Right, and if I change this to 3D, then we decrement the accumulator, right? So, oh, is it the other way around? Yeah. Yeah, you get the idea. In terms of debugging, say we wanted to put a breakpoint in the program, right? Let's go to the end of it. So this is a go to into jump back into the loop. Say we want to put a breakpoint here. Then we can simply do so by hitting SBR set breakpoint, right? And now we start the program at address 1800. You see it, the breakpoint executed. And now we can investigate the registers, for example, right? We use the rec button and see what we have in the accumulator. So this is the AF register pair, right? And we have FF in the accumulator. So that is after the first run through the loop body, and we start at zero, and when we decrement the A register, so we add FF, right? So we can simply continue now. Hit go again, right? Can do this a couple of times. And actually, we need to exit the register display in order to do that. You can hear that it is incrementing, right? And at any time I can look at the register. Now we are at DD. So yeah, and then we can simply clear the breakpoint, right? by using CBR, clear breakpoint. Yeah, so then of course you can also write your program to tape, right? So there's a cassette interface output here. So it's as simple as, you know, figuring out the end address of your program. Where was it again? Let's step through. So the last instructions were 18E3 here, right? So we have to save the program from 1800 to 181E. We can simply hit tape write, and it asks us for the file name. This can just be a number, right? So, and then we hit plus. It asks for the source where the program starts. Is it 1800? Another plus, and the end address is 18. I think I said 181E, and then just hit go. Yeah, so, and then you can read it back from a tape using tape read. And another very useful function is it allows you to compute relative jump addresses, right? So if we go again to this goto instruction here, so you might know that 18 is the opcode for jump relative in Z80 machine language, right? And so this is basically the offset by how many bytes it jumps in the address, right? So E3, this is like a negative number, so it jumps back to the loop, right? Into the loop where the accumulator is incremented or decremented. So in order to compute such an address, the monitor offers a very useful function. So say we know, okay, we want to have a relative jump here, right? So we are putting in 18 as the opcode for the jump instruction, right? And now we can actually use the rel_a function of the monitor in order to compute the offset for the relative jump. So rel_a, it now asks for the source address, right? So this is where the jump opcode 18 is. This is the current location, right? So I just confirm this. And now it asks me where to jump to, right? And I know that my loop actually starts at 1802. This is where the increment or decrement accumulator instruction is. And then I just hit go. And so it has now computed basically the offset, right? And I can simply say data and it's entered. So that way it very conveniently offers you to calculate these addresses, right? And say if I jump to the beginning of the program, right, let's try this, then the destination address for the jump would not be 1802, but it would be 1800, right? And then the program starts with loading zero into the accumulator. So if we do that, right, the relative jump address is E1. Let's input that. You see the program was changed. Now if we execute that, you would expect that the accumulator does not change its value, right? Because it's always reset by loading zero into it. No, there you go. All right, so next I'm going to present the printer. And the printer has its own EEPROM actually. And this contains a disassembler, right? So really a symbolic disassembler, not only a memory dump facility, but you can actually get the mnemonic spec from the program, right? So the way I produced these programs was I used the PC assembler program, right? So something like this, of course, you would program this in assembler, really, and then you get the opcodes that we enter, the hex codes, from the output of the assembler, and I just, you know, printed them out here so that we could enter them easily, right? And yeah, so let me demonstrate the printer next. All right, next we are trying to get a disassembled listing of our program, and So the first obstacle is actually to get the printer loaded with paper, right? It's not that easy. So this is a thermal printer. This is some metallic paper that the printhead actually doesn't use ink, but it gets hot, right? So you got to thread it through here, but then you have a hard time really, you know, getting the paper out of the through the other side, right? And so the way that I'm doing that is, as I mentioned, the printer has a number of firmware routines in ROM. So I'm writing a little program that actually uses the firmware routine PL line, drives the paper vertically by two lines, right? So that way we can feed it through. And I wish I had a button for this, like a paper or line feed button, right? But there isn't. So, you know, and that's actually a characteristics of these machines. They don't make it easy for the user to accomplish something, even something as simple as loading the printer with paper. You might already have to do some machine language programming, right? And that's what I'm going to do here. So I'm using using a jump, basically. To the line feed firmware routine. Which is at 668F. And then I'm just executing this in a loop. And that way we can now try to, well, you see that the paper is coming through here. All right, that's good enough. Let's pull it out a bit so that it's straight. Okay. Good. So we are now good to go. So I wanted to finish the point I wanted to make. So even for something as simple as loading the printer with paper, you already had to do some, in-depth, you know, diving into the machine in order to accomplish something. So these machines didn't make it easy, right, for you to accomplish something, but that way you learned something, right? And I think that's really the point of these CPU and microprocessor training trainers, right? So you have to actually delve into the machine in order to accomplish something. So I think I had to power cycle the machine, so my program might be gone. Or, no, actually I did not power cycle it, but I overwrote the first bytes in order to line feed the printer, to feed it with paper. So let's correct this by restoring the first few bytes of my program. Made a mistake. 3E003C F5 21 00 19 CD. Okay, now it should run again. And I think I still have the jump instructions, the altered one. So let's also bring that back. So the jump has to go to EC in order to jump into the loop body, which corresponds to address 1802. Still not, so let's double check everything one more time. I made a mistake. I should have simply, you know, used another address range for the printer line feed feeding operation that I executed instead of overwriting my program here. Okay. Okay, that should actually be E3. Because it's listed here, right? Okay, we got our program back. And now let's use another, or actually the main selling point for the printer, right? And it's EEPROM. It has the firmware listing, the disassembler, the disassembler listing utility, which is documented here, right? So all we got to do is we call it from address 6000. Then it asks us for the start address, which is 1800. The end address is still 181E. And go. So, a nice printout of our program, and now we can actually see how it worked, right? As I mentioned, I used a Windows assembler on my PC to write it, right? And that, of course, has the benefit that you can use symbolic labels, right? Of course, the disassembler is not able to get back the symbolic labels, so you see the absolute addresses instead here, right? So let's see what it does. So it loads the accumulator with zero, and then 1802 is where the loop body actually starts, right? So we increment the accumulator. And then next we are going to call a couple of firmware routines, right? So, and these firmware routines in the monitor ROM are used for outputting, for example, the value in the accumulator to the display, and also for driving the speaker, right? And these firmware routines, they destroy the registers, right? So we got to save our A register. I simply put it on the stack here. And then what the firmware routine requires for the display output is it requires a display buffer in memory, right? And so the start address of that memory region for the display buffer has to be loaded into the HL register. So at 1900 we have a we have 8 bytes, which are basically the display buffer, right? So, and then we are calling basically this firmware routine here, 067A, which is, if you look at my symbolic labels here, is the firmware routine hexed to 7 segment, right? So this actually produces the display bit patterns for the LED segments, right? So from the hex number in the accumulator, it puts actually it computes the display pattern for the 7 segment displays, the bit patterns, and puts it in the display buffer. So this is what 067A does. Then we restore our accumulator and we push it back again, because the next firmware routine we are calling now is actually going to output on the display what's has been computed in the display buffer, right? So the 7 segment bit pattern that displays that encodes the number, right, is now being displayed using the firmware routine 0624, which is called scan 1. So that not only puts the display buffer on the display, but it also scans the keyboard for keyboard input, and it needs to know the location of the start address of the display buffer in the IX register here. It's 1900. Then we call the routine again. That now puts the number on the display, right? And we restore our accumulator because it was destroyed again. And next, we are now calling the tone firmware routine. So this expects the length of the tone that is to be produced in the HL register, and then the actual frequency or the tone in the C register, right? And then the routine is at 05E4, so that produces a sound output here now. Then I'm restoring my A register, and then there's a relative jump here to 1802, right, which is then again the increment A, so it runs into this loop. And I demonstrated that this is a relative jump here, right, JR relative, and that 1D, so actually you only see the opcode here, right, 18 for jump relative, but you don't see the operands. But I demonstrated that we can use the rel A button to calculate this offset, right, at address 18 1E, which was 3E3, sorry. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed this little demonstration of the Microprofessor. It's a very neat machine, right? So even if you crash the CPU, you can always hit reset and continue working, right? Not a big deal, unlike with classical 8-bit home computers, right? And then please stay tuned and follow my channel for future updates on this topic, right? So next I want to demonstrate the basic, right, which is also in the ROM, in the EEPROM. And then I'm also going to demonstrate the plus version, the Microprofessor IP, the plus version, which has an alphanumeric display and a built-in symbolic two-pass assembler, as well as a force system. So this is really where the bigger machine shines. All right, guys, thanks for watching, and have a great day. Bye.